against us.
There's something happening here, but what it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there, telling me I got to beware. I think it's time we stop. Children, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down.
You were just hearing AM stereo being produced by this Harris AMS-G1 C-Quam AM stereo exciter. As you can see there, it's tuned to 1630 kilohertz. Set by this crystal here. You can change the crystal to use a different frequency, of course. And this is not really intended to be a transmitter all by itself, although it does have a jack on the back called QAM reference, which produces a low power modulated AM stereo signal, which I'm picking up on my radio here. But it's very low power. It's not even like part 15 power. It's only a few milliwatts at best. And it has the left and right audio inputs on the back, balanced inputs, so I have the plus and minus for each channel. I'm using my Amigo FM audio processor, even though this is AM, obviously. In normal use, it has a mono audio output on the back, which would go to the normal audio input of an AM transmitter, and also an RF output, which would go in place of the transmitter's carrier generator, which would not only produce the carrier signal at the designated frequency, but also the phase-modulated stereo information, allowing you to broadcast in AM stereo using this Motorola C-Quam system. Originally, Harris had their own AM stereo system, which they developed in 1979, called VCPM for Variable Compatible Phase Multiplex, and it was in use until around 1984 when they decided to give up on their own system and to join Motorola in making equipment for use with the C-Quam system. And in fact, Harris's own AM stereo exciters, which they had previously, could be modified to generate the C-Quam system. They did distribute a modification kit allowing that. And this model here was introduced in 1994 as a clean sheet design exclusively for the C-Quam system. Here is the technical manual with various revisions up to 1997. You can download this from Harris's website. You need to create an account, but it's free. And they give, if you search for AMS-G1, you can find a link to download the PDF of this. And it has parts lists and setup information and even schematics. I think that's a separate file, but you can get the schematics and everything. I was inspecting this circuit board here, looking at all the jumpers to make sure they're set correctly, looking for any signs of repairs or modifications. And I think I found a bug in the circuit. Isn't that a cute little thing? Thankfully, it appears to be non-functional, to use that term creatively. On the front, it has meters for left and right or left channel only modulation, and another meter for left minus right or right channel only modulation. And there's a switch to select between those two different modes of indication. One thing I discovered is that when you're using left and right channel individual modes, 50% of each channel adds up to 100% modulation on the transmitter. So initially I was running these meters up to 100%, which was creating 200% modulation on the air. Needless to say, it was quite distorted. But if you flip it down to this mode, you can see it's approaching 100% left plus right modulation, which is your normal mono signal that most AM radios would receive. And over here it's indicating the left minus right stereo difference information, which only AM stereo receivers can make any use of. Mono receivers will ignore this signal. As indications for the pilot tone, which is the 25 hertz signal, which is actually generated in this section right here. You can see there's a trimmer right here for the pilot level and an indicator for stereo. There's a contact closure on the back that if you remove it, or if you connect it to an external switch and disconnect the switch, it'll flip this to mono mode. A night mode, the reason for that is many AM stations use a different power level and or signal pattern at night. And the AM stereo generator has to be separately optimized to work with that night pattern. Because over here, there are various adjustments to control the amount of delay that it puts onto the left and right channels. The reason for the delay is you have your main mono audio output going directly into the transmitter, and the left minus right stereo signal is going through this exciter here. And once that gets to the transmitter, it may not be exactly aligned in time with the left plus right. So they give you these adjustments to make sure those two signals come out of the transmitter exactly in sync. Otherwise, you won't get as good of a stereo separation. And that adjustment actually includes the entire performance of the transmitter, the antenna tuner, and the antenna itself that the station uses. So it's a complete end-to-end optimization for your left and right channels here. So that's why they give you a separate night mode, which is controlled by another contact closure on the back. And this is a 10 times metering indication. These are auto ranging meters. So if you're putting a very low level signal into these, you'll automatically boost them by 10 times. So 10% input would show up as 100% on the meters if this mode was activated. On the back, we have our left and right balanced audio inputs, as I mentioned, and the mono audio output to the transmitter. The contact closures for stereo and night mode. You can see the jumper there for stereo. And these connectors are kind of interesting in that you could just pull them out like this. So in case you need to pull out this exciter for maintenance, you can just pull out these things and you won't need to disconnect your wires. And these are just little screw terminals in there that pinch down on wires. So it's a little bit of an unusual type of connector, but it certainly has its advantages. So you can just plug that back in there. And these are the various outputs. The QAM reference, which I was using to get a very low power signal for my radio. And that's the RF output that will normally go to the transmitter. And there's something called sync queue reference, which produces an unmodulated carrier for testing. There's a holder for a spare fuse. This is a little interesting here. This AM stereo exciter is specially optimized for Harris transmitters. It has special adjustments for Harris's transmitters, but it can be used with any brand of transmitter. It doesn't need to be used with a Harris. And it also has this input here, PDM sample, which takes a sample of the transmitter's RF output that would normally go to the antenna. There's a sample jack on the back of the transmitter, and this steps it down to a voltage you can use in here. That's why it says danger high voltage in this box here. And it actually measures what the transmitter is putting out compared to what the exciter is putting into the transmitter, and it compares those two and develops a correction. So it's doing like real-time correction for any mistuning that your transmitter might have, which would cause incidental phase modulation, which would degrade the stereo separation in the noise floor. So it's really quite advanced circuitry in here to get the best possible performance out of AM stereo. In this corner, of course, is the power supply, nice big filter capacitors, and the circular transformer. And this is that little daughter board with all those special adjustments on the side there. And that's about it. This is drastically simplified compared to the AM stereo exciters that were in use in the early 80s, which were much bigger and heavier and had a lot more circuitry inside them. So this is a much newer and simpler and probably more reliable piece of equipment here, because the less parts you have, the less things there are to go wrong, of course. The crystal it uses is actually four times the station's assigned carrier frequency, So in this case, it's a 6.52 megahertz crystal divided by 4 gives you the 1630 kilohertz signal that would actually go on the air.
The one thing that's really kind of cheap about this model is the front panel. When I saw this model in photos without having seen one in person, I thought this was a metal front panel with lines grooved into it, but it's really just a plastic decal, and you can see it's even starting to peel off on the sides here because the rack screws that are holding this into the rack at the station that used it. So you can see they kind of fooled you with this plastic decal on the front. But as long as it works well, I don't think radio stations really care about the cosmetics like that. And there it is with the cover installed. I like this sticker, remove all power before servicing or else a snake will bite you. And I'll leave you with some audio samples coming from this Sony SRF42 AMAX AM Stereo Walkman connected to my camcorder's microphone input. So you get to hear how this thing actually sounds on the air playing music in C-Quam AM Stereo.
Whisper in your ear, say the words you long to hear. I'm in love with you. Ooh.
He was convinced there could be no living thing on that remote, forbidding planet.
The chances of anything coming from Mars are a million to one, he said. Of anything coming from Mars are a million to one, but still they come.
Here's a penny for your thoughts, a quarter for the call, and only your mama's love. Here's a penny for your thoughts, a quarter for the call, and only your mama's love.
Incredible to me now that everyone spent that evening as though it were just like any other.